encourage my soul, and let us journey on. For the night is dark, and I am far from home. Thanks be to God, the morning light appears. The storm is passing over. The storm is passing over. The storm is passing over. Hallelujah. Encourage my soul and let us journey on. For the night is dark and I am far from home. Thanks be to God. The morning light appears. The storm is passing over. The storm is passing over. The storm is passing over. Hallelujah. Encourage my soul and let us journey on. Though the night the storm is passing over. The storm is passing over. The storm is passing over. Hallelujah. 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 The storm is passing over. The storm is passing over. The storm is passing over. Hallelujah. 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 The storm is passing over. The storm is passing over. The storm is passing over. Encourage my soul and let us journey on. Though the night is dark and I am far from home. Thanks be to God, the morning light appears. The storm is passing over. The storm is passing over. The storm is passing over. Hallelujah. Encourage my soul and let us journey on. Though the night is dark and I am far from home. Thanks be to God. The morning light appears. The storm is passing over. The storm is passing over. The storm is passing over. Hallelujah. 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 The storm is passing over. The storm is passing over. The storm is passing over. Hallelujah. Encourage my soul and let us journey on. Though the night is dark and I am far from home. Thanks be to God, the morning light appears. The storm is passing over. The storm is passing over. The the storm is passing over. Hallelujah. 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 The storm is passing over. The storm is passing over. The storm is passing over. Hallelujah. 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 The storm is passing over. The storm is passing over. The storm is passing over.
It is a joy that we serve a God who carries us to the point that the storm passes over. And we are a people who have been through some storms. Amen. And we can give testimony that God is faithful through every storm that we ever faced in our lives. And the good news is God will be faithful for any storm we face in the future. Amen. Good morning. Would you join me in this time of worship and stand with us, please? Please join me in our call for worship. Oh, come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us shout joyfully to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving. Let us shout joyfully to him with psalms. For the Lord is the great God and the great King above all gods. In his hand are the deep places of the earth. The heights of the hills are his also. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands formed the dry land. Oh, come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker, for he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand. Pray with us, please. From everlasting to everlasting, you are God. It is in the matchless and the mighty name of your Son, Jesus the Christ, we come before your throne, Lord God. And we come giving you glory and praise and honor, declaring that strength and power and majesty and might and splendor are all in your name. We come, Lord God, grateful that we are the sheep of your pasture and you are the good shepherd. Lord God, we thank you for this opportunity for worship. We thank you, God, for life itself. We ask, God, that you would inhabit this place, not just this building, but these people. Inhabit our hearts and our spirits. Lord God, that we may worship you in spirit and in truth. God, we pray a special anointing on the manservant who has been called to give a word this morning. God, we ask that you bless him and keep him and strengthen him. Guide him in the word that will be preached. And God, guide us to be not only hearers of your word, but listeners and to be obedient to the word that has been given. In all things, God, we give you glory and honor and praise. It is in the precious and the matchless name of the Christ Jesus we ask all these things. Amen.
No, not one.
seated. It is a joy that you have one person in this world you can tell everything to.
Come on, man.
There's some people I tell a lot of stuff to. But there's one person that I can tell everything to. Because Jesus is the friend above all friends. And so I'm grateful for the Lord Jesus. And I wonder sometimes how people who don't have Christ in their life make it from day to day. I'm barely holding on. And if they make it without Christ, I don't know how they're doing it. So we praise God for the lowly friend named Jesus. Good morning, Shiloh Newside and visiting saints and friends. It's good to see you today. I am Deacon Nat Harley. I'm serving as a worship leader today. It is my joy to welcome you to this place of worship, whether it is here in the sanctuary, or whether you're online, or whether you're on the telephone, wherever you may be. We're here to simply give you the one undeniable, irrefutable fact of life. Jesus Christ loves you. That God so loved this world that he gave his only son, that whoever would believe in him would never perish, but have everlasting life. That is the best news that we could ever give you. And so we are thankful for that. So we welcome you into our presence, but more importantly, we welcome you into the presence of the Most High God. And we pray that what is said today would bless your spirits, encourage your heart, and if you don't know Christ as your Savior, cause you to make a decision today to make Jesus your Savior and your Lord. So we thank you, and we now are going to be obedient to our time, and we are going to have our announcements followed by the offertory statement and prayer by the deacons. Thank you.
The University of Mary Washington is hosting a hiring event for dining staff on July 12 through July 14, 2022, from 2 p.m. to 6 p.m. There is a $500 signing bonus. Look for the red tent on University Center. If you cannot attend, access their website, umw.sodexomyway.com/jobs. The Missionary Ministry, along with the Interfaith Community Council, is announcing school dressing days in July 2022. Please see the pre-registration dates in late June and early July for the event taking place on July 29 and July 30th. Thank you for your continued support through tithes and offerings. We continue to meet the needs of others through community outreach and benevolent assistance. You may send your tithes and offerings to the P.O. Box, bring it to the Greenhouse at 513 Princess Anne Street, or online giving through the church website. Thank you for your attention.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for another opportunity to come before you, Father, to present our offerings. Father, we just thank you that you continue to bless us, Father, continue to be our Jehovah Jireh. Father, we pray that our offerings will be acceptable unto thee. Father, we just thank you for all things. We give you the glory, the honor, and the all victory, Father, in all things. And we thank you in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
It is my honor to introduce our guest preacher for today, and that is Reverend Marshall Fields. Reverend Fields is the assistant pastor at Savannah Baptist Church here in Spotsylvania, Virginia. Reverend Fields has served over time as a deacon, chairman of the deacon board, Sunday school teacher, and now as an ordained preacher of the gospel of Jesus Christ. As I said, he serves as the assistant pastor of Savannah Baptist Church and also is a coordinator of outreach ministry at Savannah. Reverend Fields is a man who served his nation. He served in the United States Navy as a sailor, and then excelled at that point so much that he was appointed to the United States Naval Academy. And upon commissioning, he became a commissioned officer in the United States Marine Corps as an infantry officer. He also told me that not only has he served in the Navy and the Marine Corps, but he's also served in support of the Air Force and the Army since he's left active duty. So this is a man who served his nation multiple times, and we thank him for his service. He is currently studying at Regent University to pursue a Master of Divinity. So we offer our thoughts and prayers as he pursues academic excellence in studying the Word of God and to enhance his skills as a preacher and a minister. Reverend Fields is accompanied by his wife, Jacqueline. Ma'am, if you hold your hand up so we can see you. Deaconess Jacqueline Fields, and the two of them have three sons, Marshall, Mark, and Scott, as well as two grandchildren. So after the singing of this next song, and this next song of ministry in music, you will hear the voice of our preacher for the day, Reverend Marshall Fields. Hear ye him. Thank you.
Praise me to God. That all honor and glory belongs to God.
Yes.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I bring you greetings from the Savannah Baptist Church in Spotsylvania, Virginia, where the Reverend Dennis A. Woodard is our pastor. And I'm glad to be here.
Amen.
Because the Word of God says where two or three are gathered together in His name, He's in the midst. And so I'm praying that God is here. He's here. I also want to recognize Reverend Donald Bryant, Reverend Dr. Donald Bryant, and the preachers of this church. I also want to recognize Pastor Emeritus Anthony Parrish in his absence. And I want to thank Deacon Harley for the invitation. And I want to thank you also, my brothers and my sisters, for coming out to the house of prayer, because you thought it not robbery to come together to worship your God.
Amen.
You've already been told who my wife is, and she is there. That's Jackie Fields, who is the love of my life, and she's the one that prays for me and makes sure that I remain before the Lord. So I'm just glad to be here one more time. So our scripture is coming from Psalm 29. Psalm 29. And there's only one verse. It's the second verse. I'll be reading from the King James Version of the Bible. And for those who are able to stand, please do so in reverence to God's word. And the word of God reads as follows. Give unto the Lord the glory due his name. Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Today, I would like to speak to you on this topic. Do we truly worship the Lord? Do we truly worship the Lord? And let us go to the Lord in prayer. Eternal God, our Heavenly Father, I thank you for all that you have done and continue to do for me. I thank you how you bless me, lead me, direct me, and guide me. Today, Father, in the name of Jesus, I ask that you touch me in such a way that you allow the preacher to come. Touch me in such a way, Father God, that I speak the words for this congregation, for those who are here in the building, for those who are online and on their devices. That, Father, somehow, some way, if there is someone that does not know you in the pardoning of their sins, that today, Father, they will come to know that they need you in their life and that they will ask you in. If there's someone, Father, who is struggling, who is backsliding, that they know that your hand has always and always will be out to them, and they can reach out to you. If there is someone, Father God, who is just having difficulties, that their faith be renewed, Father God, that they recognize that you never let us go, and that you love us so much. So I thank you for this time. I ask a special blessing on this congregation. In the mighty and matchless name of Jesus the Christ, our Lord, our Savior, and Redeemer, we do pray. Amen.
Amen.
Give unto the Lord the glory due his name. Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. For a long time, I have wondered whether we as Christians fully understand what it means to worship the Lord, especially during the recent years where things have gotten difficult with COVID, with the individuals in the White House, with everything that's going on, with the war over in the Ukraine, with everything going on. I wonder if we as Christians truly understand the concept of worship. Yes, I know that every Sunday around this time, around 10 o'clock and 11 o'clock, Christians come together, especially in the Protestant faith, and they come together to worship the Lord. But then, after we come together to worship, we go out and go about our business. Some of us, we go on, we go to dinner, and we go and do whatever we had planned to do. During the week, some of us may even go to a prayer service or a Bible study. But most of us go on and just live our lives. We go with our families and we take care of them. We go to our jobs. But I wonder, after we leave the house of prayer, do we continue to worship the Lord? And so my question to you, and when a preacher preaches, the question is to that preacher as well. Do we truly understand what it is to worship the Lord? So let's look at the first part of our scripture. And it's a short scripture, and I don't plan to be here too long. That first part of our scripture in Psalm 29 says this: give unto the Lord the glory due his name. Now, I don't want to insult anyone's intelligence, but everyone understands that that word give is a verb. It's an action word. It means do something. So the Bible is telling us to do something. And what it's telling us to do is to give the Lord, our God, the one that we call the one who holds everything together, give him the glory that's due his name.
Interestingly enough, my wife and I were kind of discussing glory. And we were kind of talking about how do we give God glory when glory is His? Well, let me tell you a little bit about this. Well, this word glory in Hebrew is kavod. And it relates to the abundance of honor, an abundance of splendor, an abundance of dignity and reverence. So the first part of this scripture is telling us that we should give the Lord, we should give our God, we should give the one we say we love, the abundance of splendor, the abundance of honor, the abundance of love, the abundance of dignity and reverence that is due or that he rightfully deserves according to his name. Now, I'm sure those of you who read your Bible, and I'm praying that everyone in here at times does pick up their Bible and read it. And quite often you're going to see in the name of the Lord. Now, here, the name of the Lord and the name of God is a respectful reference to the Lord in the demonstration of his glory and strength. And the combination of glory and strength, as talked about here, speaks about God's power in creation and in redemption. So let's talk a little bit about creation. I know that there is no one out here that thinks that we came into existence by a big bang, that two huge planets came together, collided, and there was a big bang, and all of a sudden there was a spark of life, and from that we all descended. I know none of you believe that there was some type of primordial ooze that came together and then lightning struck it, and that was the spark of life. And then there was this single-celled organism that grew from that, and then through mitosis split, and from that came out of that ooze onto the ground, and then we came about. But there's some people that believe that. No. We were created on purpose and for a purpose by the true and living God. My Bible tells me in Genesis 1 that God said, "Let us make man in our image and likeness." And what does that mean? It means that God made us unique in all of his creation. And the words image and likeness are synonymous, meaning taken together. They mean that God made us with characteristics like his own. That means that some of the characteristics are this: he made us with righteousness and with holiness. Ephesians 4, 22 through 24 says this: "You were taught with regard to your former ways of life to put off your old self, which is being corrupted and is deceitful and has deceitful desires, to be made new in the attitude of your mind and to put on the new self created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness." God crowned us with glory and honor. Psalms 8, 5 through 8 says this: "You have made them a little lower than the angels and crowned them with glory and honor. You made them rulers over the works of your hand. You put everything under their feet, all flocks and herds and animals of the wild, the birds in the sky and the flesh and the fish in the sea and all that swims in the seas." Glory and honor. God crowned us with glory and honor. The angels don't even have that. He also gave us knowledge. Colossians 3, 9 and 10 says this: "Do not lie to each other, since you have taken off the old self." And that's the way we used to be. That was before we came to know Christ and accept him as Lord and Savior, with his practices, and have put on the new self in Jesus Christ, which is being renewed in knowledge in the image of the Creator. Yes. We, as humanity, we were the pinnacle of God's created activities.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah. In redemption, after all that God did, and when he looked over what he made in 6 days, and don't let anyone tell you any differently, he looked at what he made and said it was good. And then after he made man, humanity, he said it was very good. Mm-hmm. But what happened? We fell away. We fell into sin. That separated us from God. But God had a plan. And that plan bought, B-O-U-G-H-T, bought us back with the blood of his only begotten Son. Because God said in John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that none of us should perish but have everlasting life.
Amen.
Beloved, we are supposed to give glory to God that is due his name. Because he is worthy. Worthy of glory. He's worthy of us to look at him in the abundance of honor, recognizing respect for he who made us. Let's look at that second part of our scripture, Psalm 29:2. Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. So first, we have to look at what that word worship means. So I took a little bit of time and I looked it up in my evangelical dictionary of theology, a dictionary. And the word worship is defined as demonstrating the worthiness of an individual to receive special honor in accordance with that worth.
Yeah.
So in other words, what the dictionary was telling me, it was saying that our worship demonstrates our view of the worthiness of God to receive special honor according to how we view God's worth.
Yeah.
You hear me? How we view God's worth. Is he worthy? Is he worthy of praise, glory, and honor? And we demonstrate that by our worship. So let me stop here. I'm not speaking to you so you can look over at Deacon Harley and try to determine whether or not he demonstrates by his worship whether or not he thinks God should have honor. I'm not speaking to you so you can look at anyone else and try to judge whether they are worshiping God properly. I am speaking to you, and I'm speaking to me, and I'm speaking to us so that we know when we look in the mirror, we can determine whether or not we're worshiping God properly, whether or not we decide that God should have honor, that he has worth, and we should give him glory. So my brothers and my sisters, do we really worship the Lord? But it says worship. But it says worship him in the beauty of holiness. In the beauty of his complete perfection. There is no one else that is perfect. There is no one else that is righteous. There is no one else but God. And that God looked down through time and allowed us to be his children. That's the one. Let's worship him in the beauty of his holiness. Is he worthy to receive special honor? Do we honor him in the church? Do we come to the house of prayer with the expectation that we're going to hear a word from God through the man or woman who is up in the pulpit preaching? Do we come to the house of God expecting that God will be here because his word says? where two or three are gathered together in my name, I shall be in the midst. Do you expect to see God here? Do you come to the church having prayed for the preacher? That that preacher will receive a word from God and then give it to you. Have you taken the time to worship God? Lord, have mercy. Are some of us sitting here watching or watches?
You got a few more minutes. Then he better cut it off. I've been here long enough.
Are some of us just checking a box? Because on Sunday it says that we should go to church and then we can do whatever we want to. Are we giving the first fruits of what we get back to God so that we as a community of believers can go out and tell a dying world that there is a God that loves them more than they will ever know? Are we giving our first fruits? Oh, we just throwing a few nickels. Maybe a paper $1 bill or $2 bill, if you still got them, into the plate. Because it doesn't mean that much to you. Are we worshiping the Lord with all of our time, our treasures?
Or are we just checking a box? What about our families? Are we going home and worshiping God in front of our families? One day, our church clerk made a joke, and she was saying when she was young, she had a drug habit. And then she said, yeah, her parents drug her to church. And so I'm asking you this. When your children think about when they were young and they went to church, did they think about the fact that you went to church with an expectation that you were going to see your Holy Father, that you were going to go there and worship with your brothers and sisters about the love and benefit of God? Or did they feel like you drugged them to church and you only went there because you had to? How do you feel about it? Are you worshiping God in your families? Do you realize that the only reason why we got a family is because God gave the family to us in the first place? Amen. He gave us our husbands and our wives and our children. Amen. He gave us all of our grandchildren. He gave us friends. He gave us the ability to love and to hug. Amen. Amen. Even with COVID. Amen. Are we worshiping God in our voice? I'm sure you heard this joke. There was a police officer riding in the street. He pulled over this car, and the individual asked him, why'd you pull me over? It wasn't my fault. He kind of swerved in my lane. And the officer said, well, I saw your bumper sticker, child of the Lord. But when that individual swung over, you flipped him the bird. You started screaming and shaking. I thought the car was stolen. Are they demonstrating worship? Are they demonstrating that God is worthy?
Come on.
Just putting a bumper sticker on your car is not worship. Just coming into the building is not worship.
Come on. Amen.
Some of us out here are retired, but some of us have jobs. And I praise the Lord. Right now, I haven't retired. I have a job. But I recognize that God blessed me with that job. God blessed me with the ability to get to that job. And then God blessed me with the ability to do the job when I'm there. And you know, and it's really keen to me because I work in D.C., and after I get off of the VRE and after I get off the metro and then I walk to the building, I'm passing people that live in plastic. I'm passing people that are lying in doorways. I'm passing people that have no home. I'm blessed because I can eat 3 meals a day and more if I want to. Not because of who I am, only because God smiled on me. Because God gave me his grace and his mercy. And I think that he is worthy to praise.
Because had it not been for God on my side, I could be lying in that doorway. I could be lying in that street. So you get the gist of what I'm saying. Worship is not confined to the church building. Worship involves all of our lives. We ought to live a life of worship. Every time someone sees us, they should recognize that we are a child of the King. That there is someone that we look up to, that we adore beyond measure. They should recognize by the way we talk, by the way we walk, by the way we act. It should not be that people don't like us because of our attitude. If they don't like us, because we're a Christian. Because they don't like God. No, no, no. We should be the type of people that are out there. When they look at us, they should see Jesus in us. We should live a life such that everything that we do, thank you, Lord, for the food that you have given me. Thank you, Lord, for waking me up this morning. Thank you, God, for giving me a reasonable portion of health and strength. Because my word says, even if God had just blinked, I would not be able to breathe today. So worship is not just coming into the building. Worship is not just sitting down and saying, thank you, God, for the food I have. Worship is recognizing that he gave it to you to feed your body, and he speaks to you through the word. So sometimes you ought to take time to read the word of God. You ought to sit down and commune with your Father. And that means reading the word of God. And you know what else it means? After you have read it, to step back, get quiet, and listen for God to speak back to you. You know why it's so important to read the word of God? Because this is one way that God speaks back to us. He brings the word back to us. If you haven't read it, it can't come back to you. So you have to read the word, and God will bring it back to us. Realize, like I said, that he is a God that sits high. There's a word, and it says that God is transcendent. He is so far above us, morally, physically, every aspect of his being is so high. His righteousness is so high. But there's also a word that says eminent. He is close. And last week I preached, he's less than a prayer away. He sits high, but he comes down low. When you're on your sick bed, he's there. When you walk into the job and there's someone after you, he's there. You can call him in the midnight hour. You can call him during the noonday. You can call him any day because he is God. And yes, in this world, because of sin and corruption, we're going to get sick. We're going to have difficulties. But you know what? God knew that. And he said, these tests, trials, and tribulations come to make your faith that much more perfect. Lord takes everything and turn it around for us. And we can't take the time to worship him. We can't take the time to demonstrate that he is worthy. Worthy. And it's interesting. You know, the Bible, this is the God that made us. And you know what? God made us in such a way that we were made to live forever. Back in Genesis 3, let's just read a little bit to you. Genesis 3:22 says this, and this was after Adam and Eve sinned, and God had to take action. In 22, it says this, then the Lord God said, behold, the man has become like one of us to know good and evil. And now, lest he put out his hand and take also the tree of life and eat and live forever. Therefore, the God sent him out of the garden. You ever think about that? God made us to live forever in the garden. The only thing that God told Adam that he could not do was eat from the tree of good and evil. He told him he can eat from every other tree. In that garden was the tree of life. But Adam sinned and disobeyed God. We were made to live in a garden where we didn't have to toil by the sweat of our brow. We were made to live such that when we had children, that you women didn't have to go through all these pains to bring them forth. That's how God made us, but because of sin. Because of sin. And not just Adam's sin, our sin too. The Bible tells us we were born in sin and shaped in iniquity. So God tells us we sin too. But we know that God loved us so much that even though we fell and even though we fall. And what I really love is when Jesus came down and he realized he had to die. He looked down through time and he saw me. He saw me at my very best. He saw me at my very worst. And still he said, I will die for you, Marshall. That's the type of God we serve. I will die for you. The creator, the sustainer of life, looked at me in my worst. And the Bible says that even in my best, it's like filthy rags. And Jesus said, Marshall, I will die for you. That, how can I not worship him? How can I not recognize that he deserves honor and glory? How can I not give him worship, not only in the church, but in my family, in the job, when I'm on the store, when I'm driving down the road?
Come on, come on.
Church, I'm just telling you, God is a good God. He's the one that deserves the worship. And it's more than just sitting in the church. It's every part of our lives. We should worship the one who made us, who takes care of us, who loves us more than we will ever know. Amen. So I just want to leave with you that he is the most worthy person in the universe, and our worship should demonstrate that. Not so that others can see that you love him, but that you know when you look in the mirror, God, I'm doing all of this because I love you. God, I'm doing this because you're mine. God, I'm doing this because you made me your son or your daughter. God, I'm doing this because I love you. And then someone will see the Jesus in you. Someone will be encouraged. Someone will recognize that Jesus is who they need, and they will accept him too. Amen. 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 Praise the Lord. There may be someone in that really hasn't accepted Jesus Christ as their personal Savior. And you want someone who will be there with you always and forever. My Bible tells me that no one can pluck us out of God's hands. And you know what that means? No one can pull us, drag us, snatch us. They can't even influence us out of God's hands. And Jesus said, and my Father is greater. But if you want someone that will be there when you're in trouble, when you want someone that you can talk to, when you want someone that when it gets so hard will carry you, you need Jesus. And all you have to do is recognize that you're not perfect. You make mistakes. I make mistakes. And all you have to do is recognize that Jesus is the Son of God and that he died for you to save you from your sins. Yes. And all you have to do is accept him as Lord and Savior. And you know what? His hand is always out waiting for your call. Yes. And he will come in because the door will be open and he will come in and sup with you. And he will make you a child of the King. Amen. If you're struggling, you already know Jesus, but you're struggling. And you forgot that all you have to do is say, Jesus, now is the time just to say, Jesus, I'm sorry. Yeah. I know you're there. And I'm sorry I tried to do it on my own and I messed it up. And he's the type of person that will step right on in and take care of your situation. Even if you're on your sick bed, Jesus can raise you. But he'll do this too. He'll take all of the anxiety out of your mind. Yeah, we have to be sick. Yeah, we have to go to the hospital. Yeah, we have to have operations. But Jesus is there. Touch the doctors to give them the ability to operate. And if you want somebody that will touch that doctor for you, you need Jesus. So at this time, if you need Jesus, let one of the preachers of this church know. Let them know that this is the time that you've given your life to God. Amen?
Amen.
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 We thank God for the man of God. We thank God for the word of God. And we are grateful that God implanted that word in Reverend Fields and he was faithful to deliver it to us. Are we worshiping? And so we thank God for that worship experience and that preaching moment. Reverend Fields extended the invitation. If there's one here who does not know Christ in the pardon of their sins, you can raise your hand and the deacons will see you at the service. If you're on a telephone, if you're on a device and not here with us present, you could call 540-779-7474. 540-779-7474. And we'll pray with you. We'll explain to you the plan of salvation. And we'll welcome you into the house of God. Not Shiloh, but the house of God. And into the family of God. If you choose to join Shiloh, that's fine. But more important than any congregation is to be a part of the family of Jesus Christ, the family of God. So we thank you for that. If you would, we are going to now have our altar call. If you would stand with us, please. Almighty and merciful God, we come before your throne in the name of the only one that can be our help, our strength, and our provider, your son Jesus. And Lord God, we give you glory and majesty and honor for who you are. Lord God, help us to be worshipers, not just in a sanctuary building, but in all aspects of our lives at all times, that we may worship you in spirit and in truth. Lord, we thank you for this opportunity for worship, but above that, we thank you for your son, Jesus. We thank you for the presence through the power of your Holy Spirit. We thank you, God, for your provision. We thank you for your protection. We thank you for your promises. We thank you, God, for the peace of God because we know you in the pardon of our sins. Lord God, we ask for forgiveness for our sins. Create in us clean hearts and right spirits that we might serve you and worship you in spirit and in truth. Guide us, God, that we may walk in a way that reflects your glory in every aspect of our lives. And when we fall short, God, we ask that you would have mercy on us. Guide us and direct us and refocus us on your word and on your will and your ways. God, we come thanking you for all the blessings that you've given us for life, health, and strength. We thank you for your grace, your mercy, your love, your loving kindness, your compassion, your faithfulness that never fails and that's new every morning. Lord God, we thank you for this opportunity. We thank you, God, that you will guide us to not simply hear the word, but be obedient and apply the word in our living. God, we lift up those within our congregation who are sick. We ask, God, that you would be with those who are bereaved. We ask, God, your comfort upon those who are suffering through financial difficulties, who are suffering through relationship issues, who are suffering through any malady, any issue, any disease of the body, the heart, the mind, and the spirit that may be attacking them. God, we lift up not only this congregation, but your church universal. We ask, God, that you would go forth and give us that peace that only you can provide. Lord, we pray for not only the church, but we pray for this world. We have so many issues going on, war in Ukraine, war in Africa, war in the White House, war in the Capitol building. But God, we know that you are the peacemaker, that you are the provider, and that you are the comforter. And so, God, we lift up every concern in our world, praying, God, that you would have your way. And, Lord, we lift up the need of this congregation for a pastor. God, we ask that you will be with this pastor search committee, that you will be with the candidates, that you be with this congregation. And, God, we pray in the words that Jesus said, not our will, but your will be done. Not our will, starting with me, not my will, but your will on the candidate. And God, we speak right now strength and power and peace to that candidate that you've already ordained to be our next pastor. Guide us, God, to be a congregation that not only prays for a pastor, but receives the pastor that you send us. That not we may be glorified, but that you would get the glory. Yes. Guide us now, God, that in all we do this day, you will get the glory. We bless you, we praise you, we exalt you, and we give you all the glory that is due your name. In the matchless name of Jesus the Christ, we ask these things. Amen.
All minds clear. Deacon Harley has said it all. Let us look to the Lord. Eternal God, our Heavenly Father, we thank you so very much for this day that you've given us. And as Deacon Harley has said, please continue to touch every aspect of this church, every aspect of the members, every aspect of your children. Lord, have them see your face wherever they go and recognize that you love them more than they will ever know. Father, we realize that when we go from this place, we will be going from the building, but never from your presence. So we thank you for that. And we just ask that you continue to touch us in our lives and our children and everything that we do. And we ask this all in the mighty and matchless name of Jesus the Christ, our Lord, our Savior and Redeemer, we do pray. And let this body say, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
God bless you all.